Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York in Bayside, Queens. This evening's event commemorates International Holocaust Remembrance Day, and we're delighted that Dr. Robert Williams from the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum has joined us. Dr. Williams' talk is both timely and instructive. 7 days ago, January 20th, was the 80th anniversary of the Wannsee Conference, when senior Nazi officials met at a Berlin villa to discuss the final solution to the Jewish question. 2 weeks ago, there was a terrorist attack at a synagogue in Texas, and today we're learning that a local school board in Tennessee has banned the seminal graphic novel about the Holocaust, Mouse. Today's commemoration is about education and awareness of the genocidal consequences of antisemitism, racism, and xenophobia. It's also about our responsibilities, both as individuals and as a community, to educate people who may know little to nothing about the Holocaust. It's not enough that we care. We must also get others to. It's our way of paying forward our collective debt to Holocaust survivors by finding ways to reach people from all communities and all backgrounds around the world. And it's in that spirit of collectivity that 9 other centers in the region are co-sponsoring Dr. Williams' talk this evening. They include the Holocaust Genocide and Interfaith Education Center at Manhattan College, the Holocaust Museum and Center for Tolerance and Education at Rockland County Community College, the Gross Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Ramapo College of New Jersey, the Center for Social Justice and Human Understanding at Suffolk County Community College, Wagner College Holocaust Center at Staten Island, the Holocaust and Human Rights Education Center in White Plains, the Center for the Study of Genocide and Human Rights at Rutgers University, the MLA and Jenny Fish Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Yeshiva University, and the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center of Nassau County. So now, to kick things off, it is my honor to introduce the Chancellor of the City University of New York, Felix Matos Rodriguez.
Thank you, Dr. Cohen, and greetings, good friends, and thank you all for taking part in today's deeply serious and greatly needed event. Today, on International Holocaust Remembrance Day, we struggle with the horror of a recent incident in Texas in which Jewish people were held hostage in their house of worship. A synagogue and its congregants targeted again in the United States of America in 2022. We must acknowledge that antisemitism is with us today, as is so much prejudice and hate. It is terrifying that this attack could have happened decades after the Holocaust, long after the Auschwitz extermination camp was liberated on this day in 1945. What have we learned? What can we learn? How do we learn to stop this? And why does it persist? The most effective antidote is education. We are grateful for the invaluable guidance and knowledge that the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center provides through its programs. The center's current exhibit on the Nazi concentration camp system also helps us to contextualize the tragic events and rampant antisemitism that led up to the Holocaust, issues our global society continues to wrestle with today. My own background as a historian has enabled me to grapple with the necessity of appreciating the past. We must work to respect its persistent connections to the here and now and the way it continues to reverberate today. For all of us who belong to a community as diverse as this great university, we must remember how important it is to stand in unity against all forms of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. We are united by our humanity. When something affects one of us, it affects all of us. That is a lesson I hope CUNY students will carry with them through their lives and into their communities. As chancellor of this great and diverse university, I am here to emphasize with the strongest conviction that we at CUNY will not condone religious, racial, or ethnic hatred on any of our 25 campuses. At our university, we stand united as a community of many faiths. We want each and every member of our community to feel welcome, valued, and safe, and we will continue to do all that we can to ensure that this is the case. My heartfelt thanks to all the participants here this evening, to our many sponsors, and to the conference leaders. To you, of course, Dr. Cohen, and to Queensborough Community College President Christy Mangino, and to our honored guest, Dr. Robert Williams, Deputy Director for International Affairs at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. Thank you to all.
We're very grateful for the Chancellor's message, and it's now my honor to introduce Dr. Christine Mangino, President of Queensborough Community College.
And welcome to Queensborough, Dr. Williams, and thank you all for being here. Dr. Cohen has already mentioned the numerous co-sponsors of this special gathering. Such strength is generated and presented when we join our hands, hearts, and minds. It's Queensborough's privilege to convene this presentation, and we are immensely proud to have worked with so many of you to bring about this program. Today, on International Holocaust Remembrance Day, we mark 77 years since the liberation of the Auschwitz-Birkenau extermination and concentration camp. The word remembrance speaks to our capacity as a community to recall. It is a reference to the store of deeply personal and moving stories from Holocaust survivors that we collect, document, treasure, and share. Perhaps most important in framing remembrance, it is that it is about being presently conscious of the past. And what I mean by that, presently conscious, I mean not just being aware of one's surroundings in history, but being active in them by studying, influencing, and shaping our environment and the people we share with it. Which is why I am so drawn to tonight's talk from Dr. Williams, From Awareness to Action, Confronting Antisemitism at Home and Abroad. Queensborough's action, as it were, is our commitment to combating antisemitism and creating a safe and welcoming environment for all Jewish students. The recent hostage situation in Texas, which Dr. Williams will address, is just one reminder, our remembrance, of how pervasive hate and violence are. Every day, the Holocaust is relevant to Queensborough. Our commitment to active remembrance of the Holocaust through our education and exhibits, archives and artifacts, housed at the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Center, is unwavering. Our collaborations with other Holocaust education centers builds upon our namesake, Harriet's vision to make Holocaust education accessible to everyone. Harriet was a force at Queensborough for nearly four decades. A Queens native, she went to PS 20, Bayside High School, and NYU and Queens College. She was a teacher, a founding member of the Sisterhood of Her Temple Beth Shalom, and a philanthropist. Harriet was 16 when the war started. Her father helped extricate Jews from Eastern Europe. From that, she developed a lifelong passion to help, motivate, and empower young people in crisis. And today we are in crisis. According to the Anti-Defamation League, there are over 2,100 acts of anti-Semitic assault, vandalism, and harassment last year in the United States. That's an increase of 12% over last year. These are historically high levels of hate. We know Holocaust education, the work that we do, is a proven way to combat hate. And we know that when we work together, we can achieve more together. I am grateful to be here with you tonight. Like you, I am looking forward to hearing from and learning from Dr. Williams. There is a full program of events over the coming months on the KHC website. So please make sure that you have a look and plan to come back. We want to see you again and again. And on behalf of Dr. Cohen, the staff of the Kupferberg Center, and all the wonderful people who support our work, as well as Queensborough faculty, staff, and students, thank you and welcome.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mangino. We're also grateful to introduce Queensborough District Attorney Melinda Katz.
I am grateful to join the leadership of Queensborough Community College at the Kupferberg Holocaust Center to remember, to reflect, and to stand in solidarity with the victims and survivors of the Holocaust. Today we remember the innocent lives systematically killed in one of the most horrific murder campaigns in human history. In remembrance of their lives, we always vow never again. Today, we are reminded of the urgency to vanquish anti-Semitism and any form of religious hatred, racism, homophobia, or xenophobia. We are all called to turn awareness into action and to confront anti-Semitism, no matter where in the world it may be. And it's why I am committed as the Queen's District Attorney to protect that vision of inclusivity for our Jewish communities. Since the beginning of the pandemic, our Jewish neighbors have faced increased threats of violence, harassment, vandalism, and assault. According to the NYPD data, hate crime complaints skyrocketed by nearly 100% citywide last year, with a 54% increase in anti-Jewish hate crimes. From drawing swastikas on local synagogues to vandalizing public parks and memorials, the rise of anti-Semitism is unacceptable, and we must eradicate it from our borough. Each attack is a stain on the moral fiber of our communities, and each of us must stand up and stop the spread of hate. So we pause to remember victims and survivors of the Holocaust. Let us also continue to work towards a vision of safety, inclusivity, and acceptance for all. Thank you.
We're so grateful for the support. Two brief notes. Tonight's event is being recorded, so you'll be able to find a link to the recording on our website very soon. And also, we encourage you to submit questions to Dr. Williams via the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce our esteemed speaker, Dr. Robert Williams, Deputy Director for International Affairs at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. Dr. Williams sits on the steering committee of the Global Task Force Against Holocaust Distortion and served for 4 years as the chair of the Committee on Antisemitism and Holocaust Denial at the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance. He regularly advises international organizations and governments on anti-Semitism and Holocaust issues, and is currently overseeing a major initiative that assesses European Holocaust and genocide denial laws. Dr. Robert's research specialties include German history, U.S. and Russian history and foreign policy, propaganda and disinformation, and contemporary anti-Semitism. Dr. Williams, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Cohen, and thank you, Dr. Mangino. I'm going to pull up my presentation, but as I do so, I want to begin by actually saying what an honor it is to join the Kupferberg Center at Queensborough College. Since its founding in 1983, it's really become an essential center for Holocaust remembrance, not just locally, but on a global scale. So thank you for having me. As several people have mentioned, today is International Holocaust Remembrance Day, a day during which we reflect on the Holocaust and its meaning in our lives. As we engage in this solemn duty, we can't help but be aware that one of the primary factors behind the Holocaust, anti-Semitism, remains very much alive in the present day. Indeed, this deadly form of hate seems to be growing stronger by the week, and it takes on many forms. And if we're ever going to put into action our promise of never again, we must remember that we have to go beyond words, that we must understand this hatred, and we must act. So our goal for today is to discuss this. Given restrictions on time, I'm going to beg your indulgence because I'll be giving you a somewhat broad view. My intention is to give you a glimpse of the many factors and dynamics that characterize anti-Semitism. But before all that, if nothing else, I want you to walk away from our time together tonight carrying with you a few things. First, anti-Semitism is persistent. It's called the oldest hatred for a reason. But it's not only persistent, it's adaptable. It can be flexible enough to conform to multiple environments, multiple social spheres, multiple cultures. And along those lines, and contrary to popular perception, anti-Semitism is not unique to any one religion, any one society, any one culture. It has multiple influences that include, but aren't limited to, religious bias, white nationalism, neo-Nazism, communism, populism, anti-Zionism, anti-globalism, post-colonialism, anti-Americanism, and conspiracy thinking, some of which we'll talk about in a moment. Also, contrary to our popular assumptions, not a lot of people actually know what anti-Semitism is. Anti-Semitism and the related phenomena of Holocaust denial and Holocaust distortion are real threats to our institutions, to our shared national and international beliefs, and quite honestly, to the health and safety of our democracy. And as depressing as these 4 points are, I want you to remember a fifth thing. Antisemitism is a belief system. Like any belief system, it can be changed. But to do this, we need to be patient. We have to understand that it takes time. We have to engage with the realities of the moment. And we must understand antisemitism in a more dispassionate manner. Now, a few weeks ago, I would have started with a discussion on the long history of antisemitism or pointed to trends that we've seen in Europe. But in the wake of the events that took place in Colleyville, Texas, and the media coverage of that event, we really need to begin our discussion looking closer to home. It's long been a popular assumption that here in the United States, we were exceptional insofar as violent antisemitism was relatively rare. Now, this is true to a certain extent, especially if you're comparing our continent to Europe. But as the scholar Jonathan Sarna and many, many other scholars have noted, there's unfortunately a long legacy of antisemitism in our country. Here, for example, is a drawing from a popular 19th century publication called The Judge. It was a warning to readers that New York would soon become New Jerusalem due to the wave of Jewish immigrants who came to our shores after Tsarist pogroms. But attacks on Jews went well beyond rhetoric. In 1862, in my home state of Kentucky, General Ulysses S. Grant tried to kick all Jews out of the state during the height of our Civil War. And in 1915, at the height of the scourge of lynchings that claimed the lives of thousands of African Americans and hundreds of others, a Jewish man named Leo Frank was lynched in Marietta, Georgia. Attacks against Jewish communities became even more common with the rise of the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 1960s. Just between 1957 and 1958, there were at least 8 actual or attempted bombings of Jewish institutions here in the United States. In March 1960, in Gadsden, Alabama, a 16-year-old kid threw a Molotov cocktail through the window of a synagogue. Now, it didn't explode, but people ran out, giving the attacker a chance to shoot 2 members of that congregation. Such things only became more common over the course of the 1960s. And by the 1970s, things moved north, including here where I am now in Maryland and in the DC area. Things quieted down in the 1980s. 1991 saw the Crown Heights riot in Brooklyn and the shooting on the Brooklyn Bridge of a group of Jewish students traveling in a van. And also during the 90s, we had attacks in Sacramento, in Eugene, Oregon, in LA, and down the road from where I was living at the time in Chicago. Today, we're witnessing an escalation of all of this, something manifesting most overtly through the growing number of violent attacks that really began with the Overland Park, Kansas shootings of 2014. One Jewish community after another is being subject to everything from graffiti to violent rhetoric to deadly assaults. And if you look at these incidents, you're going to see something important. You see, they're not just the product of far-right extremists, and they're not just related to religious extremism. No, the perpetrators come from various points across the ideological spectrum. They are only bound by one thing: a common and irrational hatred of Jews. In 2020, the FBI determined that crimes against Jews nationwide represented 58% of all religious-based hate crimes, which is how they classify antisemitism. Now, this was a slight drop from the 60.2% we had in 2019, but if I were to hazard a guess, this decline is not due to less antisemitism. It's due to the realities of COVID-induced lockdowns, a failure to account adequately for online antisemitism, and the different ways that hate crimes are reported in this country. You see, we have a problem of reporting these crimes, so we don't have a sense of how pervasive the problem really is. What do I mean by this? Well, there are a variety of factors, but one at least seems to be the fact that a number of crimes just fall through the cracks. In 2019, for example, 15,588 law enforcement agencies sent data to the FBI on all manner of crimes. Of those 15,500, only 2,172 reported hate crimes of any type, not just antisemitism. So we have a problem of reporting. But this problem is not just unique to the United States. And the problem of antisemitism is not just an American phenomenon. Now, a few might argue that antisemitism started with the Babylonians. I have my doubts that that Nebuchadnezzar is a common name, but I do think antisemitism really began in Europe. You see, widespread suspicion of Jews began under the Romans and was accelerated by the founding of the Christian church in the fourth century. It continued during the course of European expansion, like during the Crusades of the medieval era, or the colonial experiments of the early modern and modern periods. Over these centuries, hatred of Jews morphed from something based primarily in religion to a hatred that sought to justify itself through pseudo-scientific claims of racial or biological difference. Obviously, hatred of Jews in Europe reached its apogee during the Holocaust, but it didn't disappear with the end of the Holocaust in 1945. It waxed and waned over the decades since, appearing from time to time even during the Cold War, especially in the policies of the former Soviet Union. But today, anti-Semitism has become an all too obvious threat in Europe. 89% of Jews in the EU believe anti-Semitism has increased in their countries. 20% have family members or friends who have been the victims of verbal or physical assaults, and most disturbing, perhaps, a significant majority, close to 80%, 79.2%, don't even go to the police to report these crimes, more often than not because they feel it's pointless to do so. But even if you look at police statistics, you see rising trends. Take the 10 years between 2010 and 2020. Again, looking at official police statistics, you will see that anti-Semitism did fall in some countries. These include the Czech Republic and, surprisingly, France, where the government has taken action to curb anti-Semitism. But in most cases, anti-Semitism increased during this 10-year period. In a few countries, like Denmark or Romania, rates of increase went beyond 100%. But it's not just a problem of small countries in Europe. In larger countries like Germany, the one European country that takes anti-Semitism perhaps most seriously, there was also an upward trend. In 2020, German police recorded 2,351 acts of anti-Semitism. This was the fifth consecutive year of increase. And over the course of that decade, 2010 to 2020, officially recorded anti-Semitic crimes rose by 85%. Now, statistics are great, but they're really only the tip of the iceberg because stats underrepresent the scale of the problem due to the different ways that police, the judiciary, and others report these crimes. And in the European context, remember what I just told you a moment ago, about 80% of victims don't go to the cops in the first place. Now, there are a number of factors influencing this rise. There are more hate groups, both within our country and internationally. There's more willingness to be uncivil and so on. But there's no escaping the reality that online media has also had an influence. After all, it's easier to harass people online. Following the Anti-Defamation League, 46% of Americans were harassed online last year. 36% of these were Jews, which was a slight increase in numbers. And since we spent the better part of the last 2 years living on these, I think we can expect this number to increase rather than decrease in the near future. And how do online hate communities work? Well, online anti-Semitism and other forms of hate speech create a sense of community and shared purpose, not just between already extreme individuals, but between new adherents. It's a recruiting tool. And as several scholars like Bharat Ganesh have noted, these communities have become sort of an amalgam of different groups. You have the so-called manosphere, so-called men's right advocates who harass women, as well as the would-be red pill community, a loose collective of gamer subcultures that include neo-Nazis, anti-Semites, conservative nationalists, race realists, militia types, and others. The messages these groups share are attractive and tantalizing to a number of demographic groups. And there's some evidence that lies and misinformation spread faster online. A team of researchers assessed 126,000 tweets over the course of a decade and found that true news stories took 6 times longer to be read by people than misinformation. And why was this? It wasn't algorithms. No, it was because Twitter users, like me, seem attracted to false information. Why? Because it's new. It's unique. It doesn't really matter if it's repugnant. It feeds a human impulse to be in charge of valuable information and then to share it as a form of currency. In other words, we are the problem more so than bots. Moreover, these online cultures of hate proliferate because they're not tied to one platform. It's not just Facebook, despite all the attention we pay to it. If you take down a group on Facebook, well, it's just going to pop up on Twitter or on Parler or Telegram or TikTok or Acoon or in one of any innumerable number of places. The use of terminology they use also changes. All of these factors make governing online hate extremely difficult and argue for an educational approach more than an approach that seeks to curb free speech. I also mentioned conspiracy theories as a factor. I'm going to dive into this a bit deeper because there is an increased popularity in conspiracist thinking, but we need to know what we're talking about here. So what are we talking about when we say the word conspiracy theory, or rather conspiracy myth? Well, it's tricky because there are real conspiracies. If your friends are planning a surprise party for you, it's technically a conspiracy. Other conspiracies include crimes like a bank heist or even actions undertaken by governments. Think, for example, of the Tuskegee experiments or the planning of the Holocaust or the planning of the Rwandan genocide. But these real conspiracies were organized by small groups that tried to maintain secrecy, and most important of all, left behind evidence to prove their actions. A conspiracy myth is just a claim of a conspiracy for which there is no evidence or proof, and oftentimes no logic. And the number of these conspiracy myths are anti-Semitic. One of the earliest is something called the blood libel, something indicated by the image on the top left. Namely, the notion that Jews would murder non-Jews to use their blood, often in the preparation of matzah, around Passover. Now, this conspiracy myth really emerged in the 12th century in England, tales surrounding the death of St. William of Norwich. It then popped up from time to time across Europe during the medieval and early modern periods. It was exported out of Europe to the Middle East, roughly by the early 19th century, and was resurrected again in Europe, or rather in the Russian Empire, during the late Romanov period. A more modern conspiracy myth has also proven influential. There's a good chance you've encountered some of the themes found in something called the Protocols of the Elders of Zion. This is a book, a forgery, a fake book, that claims to be the plans of a secret group of Jews plotting to control the world by controlling the press, controlling the economy, controlling political parties, undermining democracies or monarchies, all with the goal of world domination. As I said, this book's a forgery. Short version is, in the late 1890s, Russian secret police, the Okhrana, took elements of several other books to invent a conspiracy myth focused on Jews. Why Jews? Because they were trying to play on the emotions of the already anti-Semitic Russian Tsar, Nicholas II, and warn him about the dangers of modernizing Russia's economy and industry. One of the editors in this process also wanted a job promotion. These protocols were ultimately published in 1905 and translated out of Russian in 1920, and they spread throughout the world, appearing in multiple languages, oftentimes due to the fact that elite parts of society believe the message. Here in the United States, they were popularized in part thanks to the efforts of Henry Ford, the founder of the Ford Motor Company. We have our own conspiracy myths today that have echoes of what we've seen in the past. The notion of a great replacement is something quite old, but it's been repopularized relatively recently by a French essayist named Renaud Camus. It's a conspiracy myth that native white Europeans, or in the North American variant, white European Americans, are being replaced by non-whites from Africa, the Middle East, or Latin America. It further claims that Jews are behind this replacement and are forcing it to happen in order to undermine the West. Now, these ideas have been quickly picked up by the far right on both sides of the Atlantic, including in some political parties. So here, for example, we have Marine Le Pen, the head of the far right party in France, with a copy of one of the texts behind this conspiracy myth displayed prominently on her bookshelf. And oftentimes, extremists who believe this conspiracy myth express their sentiment through anti-Semitic references to individuals like the philanthropist George Soros, or through slogans like, "The Jews will not replace us," which has been heard at multiple rallies, including the one that took place in Charlottesville, Virginia in 2017. The Great Replacement conspiracy myth is quite overtly anti-Semitic, and so too is QAnon. As you likely know, QAnon first emerged online in 2017. like the protocols of the Elders of Zion, it's a super conspiracy that includes elements of other conspiracy myths into its overall message. And what does that message say? Well, there are several permutations, but at its core, it states that there's a, or claims that there's a secret Jewish government, generally depicted as including George Soros, the Rothschild family, and others, including some non-Jews, who are in league with Satanists to control the world from behind the scenes, and that they're achieving their plans by controlling the media, controlling political parties, controlling the economy, all at the same time that they're harvesting the blood of children in order to produce a chemical compound called adrenochrome. In essence, you have the themes of older anti-Semitic conspiracy myths, including the protocols of the Elders of Zion and the blood libel. And although QAnon was once confined to our shores, it's been become a cultural export during the COVID pandemic. We see it in Germany, in parts of the former Yugoslavia, in the Netherlands, in France, in the UK, especially in the UK, and now outside of Europe in countries like Japan. And the reason this anti-Semitic conspiracy myth spreads is the same reason that other anti-Semitic conspiracies spread. They adapt to multiple environments and contexts. And just as QAnon has benefited from the uncertainty of COVID, so have other forms of anti-Semitism. In addition to the clear rise of racism directed against persons of Asian descent, we can say with some certainty that there are at least 8, probably 9, COVID-informed types of anti-Semitism. These include claims that Jews created the virus, that they're responsible for its spread, that they profit from COVID, that they enjoy the deaths of non-Jews. There are people saying that the pandemic disproves the reality of the Holocaust. We have religious leaders of all stripes claiming that the pandemic is God's punishment on Jews. Now that we have vaccines, there are, of course, people who are claiming Jews are using the vaccines for global domination. And again, we see the misuse of Holocaust imagery and Holocaust themes by persons who oppose various forms of pandemic response. The 9th form is somewhat separate, but there are also people who see the virus as a way to finish the Holocaust by intentionally infecting Jewish people. And people believe conspiracy myths. Here in the United States, for example, a PRRI poll found that 15% of Americans believe core aspects of the QAnon conspiracy theory, and things might be even more challenging in newer democracies. A 2020 GlobeSec poll found that there's quite a lot of support for a wide range of conspiracy theories in parts of Central Europe. 56% of Slovak citizens, for example, believe one conspiracy theory or another. In Bulgaria, the number is 48%, Romania 39%, Hungary 35%, Poland 34%. Why does this matter? We clearly have a global problem sussing out fact from fiction, truth from myth, and the situation is made worse by declining support for democracies and strong educational systems. Okay, so now we have a sense of some of the ways that anti-Semitism is affecting day-to-day life, but we haven't actually talked about what anti-Semitism is. In fact, anti-Semitism takes so many forms onto itself that answering the question, what is anti-Semitism, could be difficult. Now, historically, people employed a variety of ways to identify anti-Semitism, most of which amount to the if it looks like a duck and sounds like a duck approach. Unfortunately, this approach doesn't quite work unless you've been the victim of an anti-Semitic assault or maintained awareness of these issues. In the broader US public, there's confusion over the term anti-Semitism. A 2020 YouGov poll showed that the broader public can't even define Jewishness necessarily, much less agree on what is or is not anti-Semitic. So let's define the problem. About 6 years ago, the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, which is a 35-nation international body that includes diplomats and subject matter experts, I'm on the US delegation, passed a non-legally binding working definition of anti-Semitism under my predecessor. As of today, this definition has been adopted or endorsed by more than 30 governments, including 2 Muslim majority countries, as well as received positive reference by the EU, the European Parliament, the Secretary General of the UN, and here in the US by 3 successive presidential administrations. Now, I'll grant you, there are other definitions of anti-Semitism in existence, but the IRA definition has become the definition of record because it's the one most often used by governments and organizations. So we're going to only focus on that definition here. At its core, the IRA definition reads as follows. Antisemitism is a certain perception of Jews, which may be expressed as hatred toward Jews. Rhetorical and physical manifestations of antisemitism are directed toward Jewish or non-Jewish individuals and/or their property, toward Jewish community institutions and religious facilities, end quote. Look at this for a moment. What does it not say? Well, it doesn't say who's an anti-Semite, and it doesn't say who's a Jew. It doesn't even impugn a particular motive behind anti-Semitism. In essence, it says anti-Semitism is a certain type of expression directed at Jews or persons perceived as being Jewish. This is important because it allows you to start a conversation about anti-Semitism. It gives you a chance to educate. If you see something anti-Semitic, you have two options. You can start a conversation with an individual and say, hey, what you just said might be problematic. Let's discuss it. Or you can stick your finger in somebody's face and say, you're an anti-Semite. Which approach do you think will bring about the greatest amount of change? Using the IRA definition allows for that educational conversation to happen. Now, by itself, the sentences in this definition are somewhat broad. So it also includes 11 examples of the ways we see anti-Semitism. Each of these examples was the product of intense dialogue and agreement between groups of experts and diplomats from around the world over an almost 20-year period. We're not going to go into all of those examples, but let's look at a few. One example is accusing Jews for real or imagined wrongdoings. I'm going to give you an historical example. This photograph is of an individual, a teenager, 17-year-old Herschel Grinspan. It's taken in November 1938. Now, at the time, Grinspan was one of about 50,000 refugees who fled Nazi Germany for France. In 1938, he received word that German authorities had deported his Polish-born parents back to Poland. Angry and alone in a country where he was not welcome, France at the time, he went to the German embassy in Paris and assassinated a diplomat. He committed a crime. The Nazis used this crime as a pretext to launch the Kristallnacht pogrom of 9 to 10 November, which took place across Germany and Austria in 1938. Now, would the Nazis have carried out violence against Jews without Grinspan's crime? Without a doubt. But by casting blame upon all Jews for the actions of one person, they were able to build popular support and notional justification for a series of violent actions that took place across that country that November. Another form is calling for the murder of Jews in service to an extreme ideology. This is probably what most of us think about when we hear the word anti-Semitism. But we see this spanning the spectrum of ideologies, including those that oppose one another. We see it in far-right neo-Nazi groups and in Hezbollah, and unfortunately, all manner of extremisms in between. We are also aware that at times, anti-Israel critique can be a mask for anti-Semitism. Now, I want to be clear here. Nobody's saying that you can't criticize Israel. The Israeli voting electorate does that on a regular basis. No, the IRA definition states quite clearly, quote, criticism of Israel, similar to that leveled against any other country, cannot be regarded as anti-Semitic. But sometimes criticism crosses an anti-Semitic line. So here we have a photograph of the synagogue in Wuppertal, Germany. In 2014, it was firebombed. The arsonists behind this attack claimed they carried out their crime because they were protesting Israeli policies in Gaza. But they didn't attack an Israeli institution like a consulate or an embassy. They attacked a local German Jewish institution because they conflated all Jews with Israel and then decided to carry out a crime. Crossing that red line from criticism to anti-Semitism is wholly unacceptable. It must be identified and called out when it happens. But knowing when something is anti-Semitic in this context can at times be difficult. This is why you need to take into account context, investigate questions further, not always react based on gut feelings, and go with evidence, because proof is stronger than emotion. Do the research. The IRA definition can help in this process. The definition is a useful tool that can shine light on areas you might otherwise miss, but it can't give you an absolute answer. It must complement other strategies, including education on anti-Semitism. All right, two of the IRA definition examples also focus on Holocaust denial and distortion. I'm going to hone in on these as we conclude because they are so pressing. Just recently, the UN passed a resolution on Holocaust denial and distortion because it is such a growing problem. What are we talking about here? Well, Holocaust denial is somewhat easier to wrap our heads around. It's an attempt to convince people that the Holocaust and occasionally related atrocities never happened. Holocaust deniers really only have one, sometimes two goals in mind. The first goal that is always present is to make anti-Semitism acceptable. The other one is to occasionally provide legitimacy for Nazism. What does this mean? This means that Holocaust denial is anti-Semitism, full stop. It's a significant problem, but it is a less common problem in our parts of the world today than the related phenomenon of Holocaust distortion. Now, Holocaust distortion excuses, minimizes, or otherwise misrepresents the Holocaust both as an historical event and something that has relevance today. Distortion's tricky because most forms of distortion don't deny the reality of the Holocaust per se. And it's also difficult to identify the motives behind it. Is somebody distorting because they're cynical or hateful? Or are they just doing it because they don't know the facts? To a certain extent, it doesn't matter, because allowing for or excusing Holocaust distortion erodes our relationship to that historical event. Think of it this way. On a moral level, it's an insult to the memories of victims and survivors. And on a practical level, it can act as a gateway drug, if you will, to conspiracy theory, to Holocaust denial, and to outright anti-Semitism. Older forms of distortion and denial used to play havoc with Holocaust history. These are often easy enough to counter with historical facts or archival documentation. We sometimes see countries claim that the Holocaust is not an important part of national history, or that locals did not play a role in crimes against Jews. And occasionally we see attempts to make the Holocaust seem somehow humorous or suggest it had positive aspects. Blaming Jews for the Holocaust has become shockingly common. This takes on a few forms. Sometimes you'll encounter people who will say that there's something in the Jewish character, older anti-Semitic themes, that led to the Holocaust. Some will point to the very few number of Jews who collaborated with the Nazis in order to excuse crimes committed by non-Jews. And in some parts of the world, you might encounter offhand references to something called Judeo-communism, the misbelief that Jews were overwhelmingly communist. This is essentially a coded suggestion that the Holocaust was an anti-communist action. But no matter how it appears, blaming Jews for the Holocaust is an unacceptable form of bait and switch that opens the door to anti-Semitism. State-sponsored Holocaust distortion is also more common. Now, sometimes it's innocuous, like a museum presenting imagery from the Nazi era without proper historical context, but it can also be much more overt. Take this billboard, which appeared in Crimea in 2014, right before it was taken over by the Russian Federation. It suggests that the people of Crimea had two choices, rule by Nazis in a less than subtle reference to Ukraine, or peace under the Russian Federation. Now, is this anti-Semitism? Possibly not, but it certainly links to problematic imagery that affects our relationship to the subject. There are also attempts even today to honor people whose actions or words led to the Holocaust. These people have their reputations rehabilitated, whether it's through an official process like a high court overturning a long past judicial sentence, or parliaments taking official actions to exonerate people for proven crimes. Sometimes we have cultural rehabilitation because a person was a well-known luminary. Some of these figures have been venerated by religious authorities, a factor that certainly complicates matters. And there are some individuals who escaped injustice entirely and went on to fame after the war. To this last list, we must include some of the Nazi scientists brought to the United States to work on our rocket program. A few of these individuals were in the SS and oversaw programs that made use of Jewish slave labor. And why do I point this out? Because this is not just a problem in the lands where the Holocaust occurred. It is a global problem, and none of us are able to walk away cleanly from it. The use of Holocaust-related symbols is an also somewhat obvious form of distortion. Here we have the flag of Greece's Golden Dawn party. It's not exactly subtle. And most of us might see something problematic in this flag. It's of the All-German Heathens Front, a possibly disbanded neo-Nazi organization with branches across Northern Europe. And if you knew that flag, you might recognize something awry in the flag of the Nordic Resistance Movement, a different neo-Nazi band that also likes to use runes found in Scandinavian countries. But things can also be tricky. Here we have a group of American white nationalists holding the flag of the Romanian Iron Guard. the anti-Semitic and fascist party of Romania that existed between 1927 and 1941. To know why this is problematic, you need a deeper knowledge base to draw upon, and a number of Holocaust scholars might even miss it. But even if you know what you're looking for, symbols can also be hidden. So this flag occasionally appears at Legia Warsaw soccer games. The shield in the center is fine, that's part of the team kit, but the white triangles in the back are not. No, those are so-called Gibor runes, or a Wolfsengel, a symbol that was used by some SS detachments in the 1940s. All right, so what do we do? Things are bad, I don't want to minimize this, but there are also signs of progress. First among these, there are entire communities at both the grassroots and governmental levels engaging with these issues finally, talking about the problem, working with us and a few others to identify solutions. Just last year, there were several international developments, including a major gathering of experts in Jerusalem in July, a heads of state level forum in Malmo, Sweden in October, and the launch of an EU-wide initiative to address anti-Semitism in November, but there's so much more work to do. So before I leave you, I want to give you a few suggestions on how to respond. First and foremost, we must enhance educational opportunities to learn, and not just about the Holocaust, although the Holocaust is an essential component of what I'm suggesting. We need to learn about the wider range of Jewish experiences and the ways that Jews have contributed to our politics, our culture, and our society. You know, it's shamefully all too common, both here in the US and abroad, to hear educators and political leaders refer to events like the Holocaust as just Jewish history, instead of something that's part of our shared past. Why does this matter? Well, if we don't reconnect our common experience, that void will continue to be filled by imagined communities built on separation and tension instead of harmony. And as we integrate learning about our shared history, we have to go beyond the secondary school. Secondary education provides an essential foundation for later in life learning, but we also must engage with the Holocaust, with anti-Semitism, with hatred writ large, with misinformation, and so on in our universities, in our trade schools, in professional education courses, and in the training of our civil servants. Related to this, political responsibility is key. We all know that anti-Semitism and the Holocaust and related issues are often misused for all manner of political, cultural, or ideological gain. We must speak out against this misuse and not allow the Holocaust to be a weapon that one political opponent uses against another. Third, new media. There's been a lot of talk about social media companies and their responsibility to tackle online hate. And this is true, but it's only half the equation. We are the users of these platforms, after all. We also have a responsibility. And it's incumbent upon all of us to figure out better ways to communicate against anti-Semitism and hate writ large. Because frankly speaking, those who sow hate are much better at reaching vulnerable groups than we are. Finally, we need to develop opportunities for regular and constructive dialogue between like-minded causes and like-minded institutions on these issues. Anti-Semitism does not exist under a bell jar, and neither do other forms of bias. They intersect with and inform one another. Now, to be certain, each form of bias and hate is different. We need to understand these distinctions, respect them, and resist the temptation to lump everything under a generic fight against racism. But we also have to begin working together. Because if we don't do this, we will all continue to fall into decline. To summarize, anti-Semitism is a growing problem. The conditions of the moment, whether at the political, cultural, or social levels, also make it a major threat to civil peace and to our democracy. In order to fight back, we need to understand it, and we need to have more dialogue. Now, will we achieve our goals? That remains uncertain. Holocaust institutions like my home institution, the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, have devoted millions of dollars and many more millions of hours developing a host of resources that have had an effect. Likewise, so too have other Holocaust-focused institutions here in the United States and abroad. Things could always be worse, but we can't ignore the fact that the problem of anti-Semitism and a decline in respect for the Holocaust continues to grow. More work needs to be done, as I said just a moment ago. We need a path forward that harnesses these resources, that to find innovative ways to use them and make them available, And we also must reach out and engage with our local Holocaust institutions. You see, the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum is our national institution, but there are also local institutions, including the Excellence Center here at Queensborough College, as well as the centers who help sponsor tonight's program, who are resources for you. Make use of us. Work with us as we seek to build a world that actively remembers the Holocaust so that the sins of the past no longer haunt our present or make uncertain our future. With that, I'm going to shut down the presentation and hopefully we'll have some form of conversation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Williams. I've been sitting here taking notes and I'm just in awe, and there's so much that I've learned. And I wanted to invite into the conversation Dr. Manaz Afridi. She's professor of religious studies and the executive director at the Holocaust Genocide and Interfaith Center at Manhattan College. So she's going to join us. And we're going to also invite you to submit any of your questions via the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. And I guess the first question, one of them that's come in is, you know, there are many of us on this call who are Jewish. There are many people who are survivors, who are related to survivors and so forth. And a lot of this sounds familiar to many of us, which is anti-Semitism operating in our communities, but also not just as individuals, that we might be the target of an anti-Semitic attack, but there's also anti-Semitism at the international level. And I'm curious, though, in terms of the American discourse, with the overall increase in hate crimes and anti-Semitic violence, as well as the debate about history education, what's happening? Do you worry about anti-Semitism getting lost in the shuffle with all of, you know, anti-Black and anti-Asian violence, the increase in Islamophobia, the increase in homophobia, and so forth?
I do, but I think it's a longer term challenge. It's not just related to the environment in which we've lived for the last 5 to 8 years. Anti-Semitism in many ways has been lost from human rights discourse since about the mid-1970s. There are very few human rights-oriented organizations in the United States. There are exceptions. There are a couple of exceptions, but very few that address anti-Semitism as such as part of their mandate. And let's be honest with ourselves. There are a lot of challenges respecting cultural pluralism and the various communities that make up the fabric of the United States. The goal is to ensure that anti-Semitism is part of those conversations. And to do that, we, of course, have a number of very important Jewish institutions here in the U.S. who raise the profile of these issues, organizations like the American Jewish Committee and others. But we also need to make sure that this is something on the minds of the non-Jewish institutions who also advocate for social and cultural change locally. The other aspect to this that I think is important, and it relates to reinserting anti-Semitism in human rights discourse, is ensuring that dealing with anti-Semitism is an active part of our foreign policy. And on that front, I think we actually are on firmer ground. For a number of years, almost 20 years actually, we have had special envoys for anti-Semitism issues stationed within the State Department who make the fight against anti-Semitism part and parcel of our foreign policy, ensuring that that is complemented by attempts to minimize other forms of hate internationally, whether they're directed at Muslim communities or Roma communities or other, I'll use the academic term, subaltern groups, is essential because it will help ensure that not only international discourse changes, but also domestic discourse. And on that front, I think we've seen across presidential administrations actually reasonably strong action.
Manaz, I'll turn it over to you.
Hello. Thank you so much, Dr. Cohen, for letting all of these wonderful centers co-sponsor with you in Queensborough College. And Robert, it's so nice to see you finally, right? We've been corresponding for some time.
Yes.
So I'm really honored that you're here with us and that we're also sponsors at Manhattan College. So I wanted to ask a question since I'm a professor on a campus, and as you know, I'm Muslim and I teach the Holocaust, and I'm at a Catholic campus, and we do have a growing number of Jewish students, but there has been a lot of questions directed at me and also to you tonight about the anti-Semitism on campuses. And I want to just kind of frame that in a sense where it's anti-Semitism on campuses. It's also connected to what is called the cancel culture. I'll give you an example from my teenage daughter who is on TikTok. And this is really important because media is essential when we're teaching on campuses and how to look at media. So one of the things that she told me that she was bewildered by was there was a girl who had a Jewish, an Israeli flag next to her name, and she was instantly canceled. And she came running down to me and said, "Mama, what's going on?" So I had to explain to her, you know, what these different kind of cancel cultures are. This also, Robert, and I know this not from our campus specifically, but from, you know, knowing my colleagues at Columbia University and NYU, is a really big problem and is a fear that a lot of our young future generation of Jewish students are being confronted with. What can you suggest to our viewers and to us tonight?
Well, it's a very, very big question, as you know. There are, and it's something that we've been wrestling with in the United States for at least 15 years. As early as 2010, the U.S. Department of Education was beginning the process of issuing guidance to deal with particular forms of anti-Semitism on college campuses. There was a Dear Colleague letter issued at the time that was extending Civil Rights Act privileges to Jewish students as a first step in dealing with this. But as you've indicated, the problem seems to be metastasizing and growing out of control. It's almost snowball effect. And we have seen cases, not just with students being canceled in the way that your daughter experienced with this person online, but professors from universities in Israel being barred from speaking or visiting particular campuses, including at elite institutions in departments that have nothing to do with human rights. There is a case of an astrophysicist who was going to speak at a campus in California, for example. What do I advise in this case? Well, it takes a multi-pronged effort. One simple suggestion, although getting people to listen to simple advice these days seems harder than ever, is engaging in dialogue. You don't bar people from speaking at your campuses if you're trying to change hearts and minds. You engage in a conversation with them. Because if you shut the door on that conversation, change will never happen. You'll just have opposing camps that are constantly and permanently opposed to one another. So barring people from speaking or canceling them, with the exception of persons whose messages present a real and present threat to either communities on campuses or individuals, those are an obvious exception to what I'm saying. But barring people from speaking or presenting their views, whether they are far right, far left, or, you know, across the entire spectrum, whether it's religious or otherwise, it doesn't get you anywhere. Another factor that may help minimize this is engaging with and let's be honest, a lot of it is focused on Israel. Engaging with the realities of what Israel is today. You know, Israel is not an apartheid state. Israel is a functional democracy. The current ruling coalition in Israel includes an Arab party. Is it a perfect country? No. There is always a reason to criticize the foreign or domestic policies of any country, including our own. But you have to engage with realities. The problem is we live in an environment where every message is made simple, right? How many characters can we read something in? Plus, we're constantly being barraged with information. The ability of students, the ability of adults to have time to deal with nuance is very limited. So we have to figure out better messaging. And this is a statement that I make, not just in the particular case of what we're seeing on college campuses, but issues writ large, whether it's anti-Semitism or other forms of hatred. These things require nuance and they require better messaging and learning. So improve the message. And then the third element of it is dealing with what we call cancel culture these days. Let's also be honest. Some people deserve to probably be canceled for the objectionable things that they say. But it's like using top secret stamps, right? During the Iraq War, the joke was that you had people in the Defense Department and other parts of the U.S. government just running around stamping everything top secret. because it was in vogue to do. We have the same problem happening with cancel culture. If somebody is moderately offended, they don't want to engage in dialogue. They just want to make the problem go away. Ignore it. Put your head in the sand. Well, you put your head in the sand, you know, if you're still, the problem is still out there. So confront it, deal with it, do it in a respectful way, but not, don't shut the door with, again, obvious exceptions of people whose views are so objectionable or dangerous that they have no bearing on being, or no response, no right to be part of civil society.
Thank you. It's so interesting. We're just going through the different questions that people are submitting. And one of the things that we talked about initially when you were coming to present was also, could you talk a little bit about the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum's status as a federal institution? Some of the questions that have come up focus on, you know, more political queries. Was there more anti-Semitism when the former president was in office? I just won't repeat his name. And why can't we seem to get Deborah Lipschitz confirmed? But I don't know if everybody understands even your role as a person that works at the museum, what the parameters are for you.
Well, parameters aside, yes, the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum is probably best to describe it as a public-private partnership. So we're both part of the federal government, and we also receive funds from private donors. So we're kind of a mixture of both, even if we did not have that federal status, though. I personally like to take an as neutral position as possible when it comes to dealing with these issues. Why? Because anti-Semitism is not just a product of the political right. It's also found on the political left. It's found among centrists. Nobody's completely neutral, but you can't get too engaged in advocating for one position or the other based on your ideological predilections if we're ever going to address this issue in a way that has impact. Maybe it's a product of my original training in the physical sciences. I'm not quite sure, but that's just how I operate. Okay, with that said, it's important to remember that although we are aware of more anti-Semitism over the course of the last 7 to 8 years, that they're not tied to any one particular administration, that they're not tied to any particular makeup of the House of Representatives. There's a larger social political thing happening that feeds anti-Semitism. And it's not something that's just unique to the United States. Rates of anti-Semitism in France, for example, were extremely high in 2014 and 2015. Obviously, we are aware of the crimes that took place at, you know, the Hypercacher supermarket in 2015 and then the terror attack in November of that year, both of which were informed by anti-Semitism. But, you know, anti-Semitism was on the rise in Europe to a certain extent before it was even on the rise here. So there's something in the air and that has been feeding this. So what is that? And to a certain extent, it is, in my opinion, due to a decline in respect for democracies, a decline in support for democratic progress. And it's not just unique to it's my third talk today, so I'm losing my ability to speak English. It's not just due to what we could call a post-communist experience in parts of Eastern Europe, because we see it in Western countries as well. But there is something in the moment that has been feeding anti-Semitism, and I think the decline in democracies is a part of that. As for the role of the special envoy to combat anti-Semitism, for which Professor Deborah Lipschitz, who is an esteemed authority and a really lovely person as well, has been nominated, I think it's just important to note that that role has served a very good and very strong purpose, namely in surfacing issues related to anti-Semitism on a global scale. That job requires looking out from the United States, not within. When the United States speaks on something like anti-Semitism and says that it's a priority, the tendency for other countries has been to listen. So it's a very important role that exists within the federal government. And my home institution has always enjoyed a very productive working relationship with that office. I actually sometimes teach the anti-Semitism course at the Foreign Service Institute for that office. So, Robert,
you know, even though the work I do as a Muslim looking at the Holocaust, but genocide, and I also have to teach Islam. So think about, whoa, what am I doing with all this stuff? But, you know, I always want to end up with an optimistic note. And some of our viewers here are survivors, Holocaust survivors, children of survivors that have experienced personally anti-Semitism. And you've answered some of, you know, how it's different today. But let's kind of bring up some of the optimistic, the positive things that have been going on, at least as a Muslim. You know, I have a lot to be optimistic about, the growing nature of the field of Muslims in the Holocaust, me being a director of a Holocaust center. I mean, so there are things to celebrate and also different kinds of leadership that is growing, and how the Arab world and the Muslim world has come out and condemned anti-Semitism and stood with Jews yesterday, for Holocaust Remembrance Day. So let's, if you can just leave us with that note, that education is important, but also exposure is important.
Yes. Yeah. And that's why days like International Holocaust Remembrance Day are so important. You know, just thinking about why we remember helps keep memory alive. Now, the challenge, of course, is to move beyond nice words to action. And we are having some of this. Before I answer your question, it's important to note, just for the audience, that the work that Professor Afridi's been doing is really innovative, very, very interesting. If you haven't engaged with it, I highly encourage you to do so. Yes, you're right. We have a moment, and it preceded the Abrahamic Accords, but it's certainly increased since then, where you have some Muslim majority countries beginning to engage, not just on Holocaust issues, but Jewish issues writ large. And you do have more dialogue. You, Professor Afridi, have been quite successful in building intercultural, interreligious dialogue along these issues. And these things matter. These help. I do think, in light of some of the violence that we've seen in the New York area, we need to export those models for engagement between the Jewish community and other communities as well, in the hopes that it leads to some form of reconciliation and common understanding. But it is a sign of progress. And I mentioned this in my comments earlier, but I don't want it to get lost. The very fact that we are having more and more conversations about this, the very fact that today we had world leaders holding up various signs to indicate that they remember International Holocaust Remembrance Day, these are also signs of progress. But again, those are, you might want to dismiss them as performative. So let me get down to brass tacks. What other signs of progress do we have? I'll start internationally. Across Europe, an EU-wide action plan to deal with anti-Semitism and to improve Holocaust awareness and education. At the national level, across Europe, both within and outside EU countries, Norway has one of the better of these, you have national action plans to deal with anti-Semitism. And you have heads of state over and over again saying, our country, our Europe is not the same if we do not have our Jewish communities. This is not something that would have even been possible to imagine 25 years ago. Here in the United States, we're having similar conversations. We are very, very unfortunately witnessing more and more attacks against Jewish communities. But what we are also seeing is what makes us, well, I'm going to sound like a campaign from the 1980s when my mom was working for the DNC. But you know, we're seeing the best of America sometimes in the wake of these tragedies. Communities coming out, showing solidarity, political leaders promising to take action. Now, are they all taking action? Of course not. But over time, it's beginning to accumulate. And we do have more education on these subjects happening, both domestically and internationally. Huge intergovernmental bodies like the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe have developed 10 teaching curricula on how to teach Holocaust and anti-Semitism history for people to use. We have resources, people are using them. Things are getting somewhat better on the one hand, but very bad on the other. My hope is that we are at a moment, we're at a tipping point where we might finally be able to push aside the devil on our shoulder and focus on the angel. But there's a lot of uncertainty, and there are a lot of other factors that are at play. I mentioned Holocaust denial. Well, Holocaust denial also doesn't exist in the vacuum. We live in a culture of it's not my term, of denialisms. We have people that deny climate change. We have people that deny basic science. We have people deny that the earth is a sphere. So, you know, we've got a problem, but people are beginning to wake up to this problem and push back. Is it going to deal with the 15% on the margins? I don't know, but I hope dialogue takes that 15% and makes it 5 over time.
Robert, thank you. Manaz, thank you. I was thinking about a study that our center did where we were looking at, especially during the coronavirus and during the pandemic when everything has been closed, what is the value of centers like ours in terms of delivering Holocaust education? Can we do that effectively virtually, or does it also need to be in person? And one of the things that we assumed was that younger people would just naturally gravitate toward the web. And what we found actually is that the assumption is that every single site, every single organization should have a website, but really what resonates mostly with them is the ability for them to go to places like the Kupferberg Center, places like the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. Many people on this call, myself included, have been to numerous Holocaust memorials, former sites of concentration camps related to the Holocaust, but young people don't necessarily have that connection to the past. And so the work that we do is all the more relevant. And as you talk about how do we focus on all these different international efforts that are taking place, but at the same time, thinking about how does this play out in our communities? We just want to thank you very much for really kind of teasing all of this out. And I also wanted to thank all of the co-sponsoring sites, Rockland County, Rockland Community College, Ramapo College of New Jersey, Suffolk County Community College, Wagner College, Manhattan College, which is Manaz's center, Rutgers, Yeshiva Universities, and the centers in both Nassau County and White Plains. We also wanted to thank, on behalf of the City University of New York, Chancellor Rodriguez, also Bruce Diamond and Renee Ontal in the CUNY's Media Relations team. Very special thanks to Dr. Mangino, QCC's president, Stephen DiDio, vice president of Chief Communication and Marketing Officer, as well as Michael Donahue and Alice Doyle and his team. Thank you very much to District Attorney Melinda Katz and Kathleen Boehm in her department. And last but not least, the Rockstar team at the Kupferberg Holocaust Center, Marissa Hollywood and Victoria Fernandez, Carrie Lane, who is Associate Professor of English and also our curator in residence of our latest exhibition on the Nazi concentration camp system. And we are always, always eternally grateful for the QCC Fund Board and the KHC's Advisory Board. Thank you all very, very much for joining us this evening. We're so grateful. Thank you, Robert. Thank you, Manaz.
Thank you for having me.